All right, you're asking for it, so here it is. Listen to this.
All right, welcome, welcome, welcome to DP Quarantimes number 10. Yes, this is our 10th episode, Diaz. We've been doing this now 10 times over, shit, we started in the summer.
We've changed format
several times, doing it this way, trying to do it socially responsible. But it also gives us the opportunity to bring in guests from all over the country, all over the world. So be looking out for some great things with us. You know, even though the format's changed, the funny's still the same. Dayton came here with a brand new face. This shit is weird.
This shit is bad, man.
I am half of the hosting tandem, Ed Bailey. I'm joined, as always, with my co-host, Dave Bracey. Say what up to the people.
What's good with you people? If you're looking for us, you can find us on epiccastnetwork.com/partnerspod. You can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, Libsyn, Google Play,
Googleable,
and Spotify under Drinking Partners. You can find us on IG, Twitter, and Facebook at PartnersPod. We've been asking you for a while, and we will continue to ask you, please hop on iTunes, hop on Facebook, rate and review. That's how we know what we're doing well. That's how we let others know that we're doing well. And that's how we continue to do well. So please hop on iTunes, hop on Facebook, rate and review.
Listen, you love us. You used to see us out in public when it was open and tell us that you love us. Now we need you at the click of a button to please tell the internet, please tell the world, please run, tell everybody, all right, that Drinking Partners is what's up. And not just tell them that you love us, right? Tell us what you want to see from us, who you want to see on the podcast, you know, how you want us to expand and level up, you know, what you've been seeing out in the digital space or in the podcasting space that you think will work for us, all right? We are men of the people. We are out here to serve the people. We're here to, you know what I'm saying, promote everything that's going on within the craft industry, but most importantly, what's going on here in the city of Pittsburgh, all right? And again, at the click of a button, let us know. So we always got to shout out, you know what I'm saying, Car Guy DJ and the Conways, because as always, in lieu of rates and reviews, we do accept shots of Hennessy. All right, so if you see us, send us some shots in the mail. Send us up to work hard and all that stuff.
They get the little, in the Conways, you get the little shots. What is it? Very COVID-friendly. It's a very COVID-friendly, nice way to just say, hey, love the cast.
Yeah, man, and in the spirit of supporting local, you know what I'm saying? Folks who always support us, man, Farm to Table, we got to shout out. Shout out Farm to Table, man, Aaron Hart and the crew, man, always doing great things, always making sure that our communities, you know what I'm saying, we address food insecurity in our communities, and more importantly, eating fresh, you know what I'm saying, eating fresh produce, all that stuff, man. Farm to Table, that's what's up.
FarmToTablePA.com, if you're looking for them, man, you know, you don't have to be rich in order to eat well support local restaurants and small businesses. So if you're looking for that, if you're looking to connect, shout out to Aaron Hart and the gang. Shout out to Jackie Page again, doing big things.
Yo,
out
love
there.
Rocks love Cafe. Love Rocks, go out mean. There, man. Get some food.
Yo, the best shrimp and grits in this, man. I say that with a full chest. Best shrimp and grits in the city. FarmToTablePA.com. But yeah, speaking of small businesses, super excited to get into this one with this guest, because I mean, we've been in Allentown like the 210.
The 210.
The 210.
I think I'm part of a crew now with the 210. Like, you know what I'm saying?
For a while, like, this whole cast has been broadcast
from day one.
From day one.
All 200 or 300 odd episodes, except for the ones where we're on site, all in the 210. And it, if you haven't been up around this way, man, just a mixture of different communities, so to speak, but like a good group of people, a lot of shit going on. And our guest today, man, I would say one of the champions of the 210. He don't have a 210 on his chest. He got a specific portion of it. But this is actually our first film director that we've had on the cast, if I can. The film director. So, okay, we got, you know what I'm saying, local talent, man. Local talent, local champion, man. We got Jay Roughbone White in the building. Say what up to the people.
What's smacking? What's cracking, people? How y'all, man?
See, that's a hood PGH brother,
rough
right there.
Bone intro.
Roughbone. How you get that name, Roughbone? Like, where you get? Is that?
I got the name Roughbone when I was about 13 or 14. I was real skinny, but I used to whoop a lot of ass in the hood, man. When I was young, I ain't gonna hold you, bro. I was real bony. And my man Raven, he live in Vegas now. He named me that, and I hated the name at first because I was real bony, but I was rough. You know what I mean?
Well, you had to. If you skinny and light-skinned, you had to fight. Because you was the motherfucker that motherfuckers just assumed that was...
I knew he was going to latch on at that point.
Yeah, hold on, bro. I'm brown-skinned, man. Light-skinned, bro. I'm brown-skinned, man.
We not starting off with the color. It be your own people, right?
And you ain't put me in the boat with y'all, man. I'm brown.
Hold on. I'm the brownest dude on the cast. Hold on. I'm the minority.
Already shots fired.
So you are from, I would say, and I said it jokingly, but I really do believe, of all the folks that I've seen and just following you on social media and stuff like that, like the way you rep for Bell's Hoover, right? And again, because I live in the 210, I take that personally, like, yeah, let's do that. You know, it helps all of us. You know, the way you rep for that community, man, I do applaud. I think it's special. I think we need more folks like yourself. Coming from Bell's Hoover, like, how did you get into film direction?
Oh, man, I got into film directing. First of all, I wanted to say about the South Sioux. So I got the SZ on my hat. That's short. It's Bell Suver, but we call it the South Sioux because we're on the South side and it's short Suver. So, yes. You know what I mean? South Sioux. South, but
okay.
Our neighborhood.
We connected now.
But our neighborhood is a different demographic. Just let me explain that. Because Bell Suver is the only Black community on the South side. So you had two housing projects, St. Clair Village and Arlington Heights. So Bell Suver was the only predominantly Black community with housing on the South side. So everything else was all white neighborhoods. So we was always surrounded by white people all around the South side. Now Knoxville was more of a mixture, but Bell Suver was the only predominant Black neighborhood on the South side. And still to this day is. But you know, Allentown's more mixed now. Back in the day in Allentown in the 90s, it was all white people. Black people started moving to Allentown years later. Black people started moving to Mount Oliver years later. Mount Oliver, you rode up Brownsville Road in the 90s, you wouldn't see no Black people. You might see one or two Black people.
My boy got an apartment in Mount Oliver around like in the 2000s, like in the aughts. You know what I mean? Yeah. And that was when like he was closer to like, you know what I mean, like that main road up there. Was that Brown?
Brownsville Road.
Around that area or whatever. Like, and I thought I saw a few Black folks back then, but like.
Yeah. There was, but it was always predominantly white neighborhoods over here on the South side.
That's
wild. So it's not like the East side where you go to the Hill or, you know what I mean, right. North side where you got a lot of different Black communities. So that's the unique thing about Bell Suver, you know what I mean, that a lot of people don't know. A lot of Black people in Bell Suver had money, you know what I mean? People was homeowners because they moved from the projects into Bell Suver to a middle class and high class Black neighborhood, you know what I mean? So that's just a little demographics about it. So a lot of us come from good families, you know what I mean, good stock. You know what I mean? Families with morals and stuff like that growing up. So it's you know, it's still embedded in us. But, you know, a lot of people, you know, passed away. The streets happened and stuff like that. But a lot of us come from good stock in our neighborhood. But to get into how I got into film, me being young, I was always interested in cameras, but I never like looked at it like that. My granddad would go over to Africa. My granddad's a pastor. He's a reverend. And he would do missionary work. He would go to Africa. He'd been to Africa probably like 19 times, though, so many different countries. And he would take the old school cameras over there with the VCR tapes in them, them old joints, you know what I mean? And he'd come back with the tapes, and I'd always be interested in watching the tapes. And he would like film our Thanksgiving dinners and stuff like that. And I would always look at the cameras and was interested in it. But I never like, you know, looked at it like that as being young. And as I got older, I would have little cameras, like little mini DV cameras with like high 8 tapes in them. And I would just film shit in the hood. You know what I mean? But I never like had editing software or nothing like that. I would just film us on the block with fiends and just, I would just get the tapes put on like DVDs and stuff like that way back in the day, or just have the tapes of it. But I never like looked at it as becoming a film director. I was just, you know, filming the environment.
I was just documenting
the environment. Me and my friends on the block, or we would just have parties and I would film them and just had the tapes of it. I didn't take film like serious until I moved to North Carolina. And I was inspired by a few people. One was my man Hannibal. He does the Transitions web series that's on Amazon Prime. So he had came to Pittsburgh back in the day and did a documentary. It was called Overdose. This was like in like 2001, 2002. And he was going from Pittsburgh to D.C. to Baltimore. He went to Houston, Texas, and I think he went somewhere out West Coast. And he had put like this documentary together. It was like rappers and, you know, hood shit. And it was dope. And I'm like, damn, that was pretty dope. So when I had end up, I was rapping. I used to rap. And when I had end up moving to North Carolina in 2004, I had two music videos. And this was when YouTube wasn't really cracking like that. It wasn't all the tutorials and all that stuff on there. And I was like, I don't know what I'm going to do. I had two rap videos. And I was like, I didn't know how to put this project out. I had a CD and I had two rap videos. And I was like, I didn't know what to do. Like, I was like, well, maybe I could get a little camera and just start filming my hood and make a little documentary about my neighborhood with my music videos in it. But I didn't know anything about editing software. So my man, he ended up downloading a program on Sony Vegas. He ended up off of LimeWire. Y'all remember LimeWire back in the day?
Yeah, hell yeah. Stealing a bunch of music on LimeWire, watching it download. Like, I'm going to have that song. 5 minutes, I'm going to have that track.
Yeah, I mean, we old. Napster. Right. From Napster on, all the emules and shit, like every pirating software.
So my one homie, he downloaded Sony Vegas. It was the editing software off of LimeWire. It was like Sony Vegas 3 or 4 or some shit. And he was like, yo, I don't know how to do nothing with the program. All you do, he said, all I know how to do is you hold Control C and that cuts the video and the audio clip. Cause I just had tape, you know, I was like, well, all right, cool. And that's all I knew from then. That's all he knew. And I just kind of ran with it from there. It wasn't no tutorials then. And I was like, I'm gonna just make a documentary. So I came into the game doing a documentary from the jump. So that was like basically my first project was doing a documentary and film. Wow. So it kind of like set the tone. And once I was like, damn, as I started filming my hood, I said, what if I could go through all the neighborhoods in Pittsburgh, all the hoods? And I was like, I'll just make a whole hood documentary. And I made a flyer. DJ Schizo pressed up the flyer. It was like PGH Hood the Hood, Rep Your Neighborhood. And I put my phone number on it. And I just had 5,000 flyers. And I came back from North Carolina and I just passed them out. And people just start hitting me up. Yo, I want you to come to my hood and film it, blah, blah, blah. And I really didn't even know what I was doing because some of the audio and video clips wasn't even lining up. Like the shit was off. It was like Kung Fu movies a little bit. But I was doing it. You know what I mean?
You was the only one.
Right. I was like, but it was no teachers for me. There was nobody for me to call and get, you know, like now I could call somebody like, hey bro, what's that program?
Yeah, blah, blah, blah. Yo. You could Google that shit and get the whole, yeah, right. You get a Harvard doc on it and shit.
It was no YouTube, none of that. So it was just a whole learning curve and I was just learning. And then I just kind of like got into like, I was like, well, I'm going to start charging some of the artists to get on this documentary. The documentary is called Blocks, Projects and Entertainment. You could go on YouTube now and see it. It's wild as shit. It's just Pittsburgh at its rawest form. This is like 2005 to like 2008. I only filmed for like 3 years, but I documented so much.
I was here too.
Shit. You know what I mean? You'll see neighborhoods on there, the wild gangbanging days. You'll see some wild shit on there. But I captured a lot of music artists in the city too. And I let people see themselves that would never see themselves in the city. You know what I mean? So I went through East Hills, Homewood, Bell Suver. I went out Braddock. I went to the Hill, Northview Heights. Only place I didn't go that I wasn't going to go was St. Clair Village because just the bad blood that both of our neighborhoods had for like the last 30 years. So I was like, I wasn't going there. And it was like anywhere else was basically fair game for me to go to. You know what I mean? I just was hitting guys up and I was just getting passes to come to these neighborhoods. That's why a lot of dudes still to this day rock with me because I bridged the gap. I started out with a documentary and I got it from here outside of Pittsburgh. So I ended up getting a distribution for it. It just, all the shit just happened so fast. I ended up hitting up Tape Man Inc. in New Jersey and Black Star Video in Harlem. So I would just get
Black Star. They did the battles out there at Black Star.
Yeah, so Smack. They was a Harlem. They was a whole little CD DVD store, and I had a distribution through them, and it just moved so fast. And I was just moving units. I would send them like 200 DVDs at a time. I was selling to them for like $5, but they're getting $200 to $300 off of me. Yeah. You know what I mean? But I'm on the street selling the DVDs for $20. So this is when the DVD game was lovely.
Yo, the DVD game back then, I used to have some spindles. Like, yeah, you know, my boy had the burner, would drop them off. Yo,
yeah. So it was dope getting into the game. fresh doing documentaries. So, you know what I mean? And as I got, and as I learned more, I just grew, you know what I mean? Got better with the graphics. I had one of my homies, he was doing my graphic design with the covers and stuff like that. So it just kind of grew. And I was started doing music videos within the documentary. So I was doing dudes' videos. And then if dude had a video, I would just charge them to put their video on the documentary. So it kind of like just put me, plateaued me past people that probably was, and it wasn't really no video guys. I kind of, truthfully, I made being a cameraman in Pittsburgh cool from a street aspect. You know what I mean? Because there was really no street dude with cameras in Pittsburgh. I was like the first dude who was really like a street dude with a camera in Pittsburgh. Like there was nobody going around with a camera in Pittsburgh that was from the streets.
When you think about it, though, I mean, the two worlds kind of collide, right? Like most street dudes don't want to be caught on film. I find it interesting that they would even give you a pass. Yeah. To do that, you know what I'm saying? Like, I ain't tried, but I don't know how many hoods you go through. Like,
there was a lot of dudes, you know, when I came to neighborhoods, they like, no, I'm cool, bro. But it was so many dudes like, you know, people, you put a camera in front of them.
And that's the thing, though, is that because a lot of it is, there's no platform. There's not a lot of platforms for us to tell our stories by us. You see what I'm saying? Typically, when a camera is pointed at us, it's by white people in some narrative that they're trying to paint. You know what I mean? Like, so to have like somebody that looks like you be like, yo, I want to tell your story. Like it adds a layer of authenticity, at least a layer of trust that, you know, through as many interviews as we've had, and we, you know, and that's what I've noticed with our podcast, or whatever, is just like talking to black folks about black shit is like, people want to talk about that shit. You know what I mean? Like, and not have it, but like, as many interviews or whatever, mostly we're talking to white folks that are like asking us questions, and there's not a lot of black media outlets out there at all that are doing it consistent. Like, yeah, I mean, because like, you know, so it, what have you seen? Like, I don't know. I mean, you've been doing it for some time now. Like, what are some of those hurdles in getting into, like, you know what I mean? Like, cause you know, what you've done is crazy. And then, and connecting the city and all that, why aren't more folks out there doing it? What are some of those roadblocks?
So, a lot of dudes get caught up in the whole, and it's not a bad thing. A lot of dudes who got cameras in the city, they get more caught up in the just being around rappers aspect. You know what I mean? Being on the rap scene aspect, and which is nothing wrong with it, you know. But you'll end up pigeonholing yourself, and that's what I did for so long, because I was like, I'm doing it, you know. After a while, I stopped doing the documentaries, the hood documentaries, because it came to a point like I didn't want to really put that message out no more. You know what I mean? I was like, I still was doing music videos and stuff, but it was just like I was kind of in too deep with it, because I was going to one neighborhood and they fuck them, and then I gotta go to this neighborhood now because they done said fuck them.
You got it, and you the one put it out there.
Yeah. You can't be biased as a journalist. Right. Yeah, I mean, exactly. you gotta
put that disclaimer. None of the views expressed in this music video are that of Rough Bone.
The truth. Yeah, I mean, like, you know, you can't be Fox News out here.
Yeah. So I was like, and I came to a point like 2008. I did the last one. I did three of them. You know what I mean? I did Volume 1, 2, and 3. But what was so dope about it? I got it across the globe. I had people calling me from all types of cities that had never seen Pittsburgh, never even knew black people lived in Pittsburgh. They never even like, man, it was like, hey, I got this documentary, man, because I had my phone number on it. They was like, yeah, you. I said, yeah, I'm the producer of it. They was like, man, I like that. I ain't know y'all was living like that. You know, man, these dudes was going to pay me all this money to come to St. Paul, Minnesota and do a documentary for them, yo.
See, that
they
was going to
fly me up here. But one of the main dudes or something, he ended up going to jail. They was some bloods. And they was going to fly me up there. They seen my documentary, and people was calling me from Houston, Texas, California, all types of places that never had seen Pittsburgh. So I was basically kind of able to put the Pittsburgh on a map through the hood. You know what I mean? For people to be able to see the neighborhoods and what was going on here. And it wasn't just like me to try to glorify. I was just showing this is how we live.
Yeah,
this is how we're living. And this is what's going on in this environment. And nobody else ain't gonna tell the story, so I'm gonna tell it. It's just like when people go to these foreign countries and it's like, man, look how they living. You know what I mean? It's like, damn, We didn't know that.
Yeah. And then, yeah, but motherfuckers don't know, like, because people keep saying, you know, these days with the, you know, Texas and all these, you know, but like, you know, it's like, oh, you know, it's like a third world country. And it's like, nah, that's like the hood. Like, yeah, I mean, there's like the hood, you know, you get a cold weather for a long period of time. Somebody's shit is, you know what I mean, some power outage, whatever. They're going to service the rich areas first. Yeah, you know I mean, they got all that or whatever. But like a lot of folks be stranded in a lot of these cities, you know what I mean, and have that. And it's like, but these stories aren't being told, mm-hmm. you know what I mean, you know, like in a real, like you said, like a black on black lens. You know what I mean? It's told through the narrative that they want to, what they're comfortable hearing. And like, you know, and that's what I appreciate about what you do is the like, yo, this is like, we ain't got to go to Africa to see black people suffer. You know what I mean? Like to see or see, you know what I mean? Tell different stories yeah, or flourish. Or you flourish. Know what I mean? We could
talent out this.
You know what I mean? Yeah, too. we can point it here.
Yeah. It was definitely a great situation, man. And then it, you know, it had its backlash with it, you know, and stuff like that, because it was too raw for some people.
Right.
Me, I was like, it's regular everyday living for me. You know what I mean?
Well, this like, early in it being captured too. Like I remember right. those first YouTube days. I remember watching right. Joey Jihad get knocked out in Philly, and like that was a big thing. You know what I'm saying? Like that viral back then was different. Like to go viral yeah. back then, the impact is just a little bit more. Because you have to find it. There were no right. influencers. There were no mm-hmm. soundboards for just
yeah, there wasn't any nobody old to post it for you. There wasn't like how it is now.
Yeah, so if it made it to your desk, yeah. like, you know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. I'm in college when the YouTube shit like really started to take off. So if it made it to my search engine, then it had an impact. And I may have even come across, I don't even remember, because back there were some hood DVDs of sorts. I know hood documentaries. Had like they had a time,
yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, with a DVD game,
and you do want to
like sling it out the trunk, like
yeah. And like for me being in Pittsburgh, like I did want to know about them. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm from East Cleveland, so like I come from East Cleveland. I come here. I'm only on Pitt's campus, but the Hill District is right up the street, and I'm hearing about it, but I don't know nothing about it. And they're right. telling me I got folks around here telling me don't go up there. Or I remember. The Pitt campus, like we had the shuttle bus and it would go down Center Avenue and then turn, I think, up Negley and like, you know, East Liberty is a little further. And like, they'd be like, yo, don't go over there. Like, I'm like, why don't go over there? Like, what's over there that's so bad? Like, and I remember I went over there and I was like, oh, this shit is regular. Like, it's a shoe spot. You know, that's when Sneaker Villa was on Highland. And it's motherfuckers walking around. It felt like life. I felt that energy, right? You come from that energy. You constantly seek that energy. Like, even though we want to get out the hood, right? We always kind of seek that same, something about it.
You need that hood authenticity, man. You got to be in the hood to get your hair cut. And, right. You know what I mean? It don't even feel right, bro. It doesn't feel right when you know what I mean? When I moved to North Carolina and, you know, I was down there. I lived in the suburbs part. And I felt like being down there was cool, was great for my kids. You know what I mean? I used to travel a lot of cities in North Carolina. But just being in Winston-Salem, I'm like, bro, this is a retirement city. This city's draining my soul. It's draining the soul out of me. Like, I had friends that lived in the hood and stuff like that, but I was like, I don't want to live in necessarily like in the smack dead in the middle of the hood, but just being in that type of town and it really didn't have a lot going on. It just was like draining my soul. I was like, man, I'm losing my soul. I ain't even got no swag no more. I'm over here
I'm rocking Sperry's and slacks. But I think that the communal, so the hood, like there's a different type of communal where we come together to aggregate our assets, our resources, right? Like we understand the limited resource and how we can kind of divvy that out and everybody can win. Whereas sometimes you get into a suburban atmosphere, it's like protect my own resource. So I've accumulated a certain amount of stuff and we collectively will now protect our own individual kind of things. We don't necessarily pour into the community itself. We want everything to look a certain way, but nah, that whole borrowing sugar shit, that happened in the hood. That don't happen. I don't think that happened as much in the suburbs. Like that happened in the, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know who you can go to get certain things and that energy is real. And so now you're doing the hood DVDs and now as you've grown, you're what, a decade separated from that. Now you're more, I guess, a maybe activist kind of space where you're
connecting with community groups and making sure resources come into that neighborhood and things like that. Like, how do you get back to Pittsburgh and then be like, you know what, I'm going to mobilize these efforts for the community in which I grew up in? Because a lot of people, you know, in Pittsburgh, you get to a certain point, you get your degree, and you ghost. I know that for my friends who came to Pitt, it was get the degree and be out.
Yeah. So when I moved to North Carolina 2004, and I came back to Pittsburgh 2013. So I was down there for 10 years.
Okay.
So mind you, I've lived in other places outside of Pittsburgh. So I lived in Fort Leavenworth, Kansas for a year in 11th grade. And then when I got out of high school, I lived in Mannheim, Germany. So I've lived other places. So I've seen other things outside of Pittsburgh. And I knew the world was always just bigger than Pittsburgh. You know what I mean? By me being able to move and go and be other places. But coming back, moving back, I had a business called The Plug Media on Carson Street. So I was still in the music scene, 2014, 2015. We was right smack on Carson Street. It was on 10th. I can't even think of the address right now. It was between 10th and 11th Street.
By that gas station.
Right across from First National Bank.
Okay.
Right there on the same block as Jack's Bar. Yeah. So we had the whole multimedia space, me, Doran Williams, he calls himself Star Namor, and James Webb. So we had the whole multimedia space for like 2 years when I came back. And then I had started managing an artist, Lua Proc. And first I was doing the videos for him. He had another manager and we was going on tours. We ended up going on the Get Loud tour with Bone Thugs and Harmony.
Oh, Rough Bone. He was about to be the sixth.
Yeah, right. Then we ended up doing a tour with Lil Reese, the Chicago rapper. We ended up doing some tours with Joe Button. So we was traveling a lot. And it come to a point where it was just like, I just got tired of being on the music scene. You know, a lot of stuff just happened. I was getting older. Mm-hmm. And I was just like, I'm doing all this stuff for all these rappers. And I'm like, I'm more talented than all the people I'm doing work for. That, to me, how I feel. People might be great rappers, but I felt like I'm putting everybody else's stuff first before my own. You know what I mean? It came to a point, it was just like, it was time for me to move on from the music scene. Now, I still do a documentary for somebody. I ended up doing a documentary in like 2017 for OE. It's called Stay Down. Check it out on YouTube. It's dope as hell. But it didn't really get promoted. He had some stuff going on in his life at the time around after we finished it, he was going to put it out and put it on big platforms, but you know, stuff didn't go like that. But as I get back to it is I just felt like it was time for me to move on to the music from the music scene and start putting my own self first and just start being more involved in other things to get real money. Cause I was doing a lot of music videos for a lot of artists. And I was like, man, a lot of these dudes don't really got no money. And there ain't no knock on the rappers because it's a lot being a rapper. It's a lot that goes into it. You know what I mean? It's a lot you got to do. You know what I mean? You got to pay producers. You got to get songs mixed and mastered. So when it came to the video set, I had a certain standard, a certain money I wanted. And it was like, I could get it, but it just was like, I just got tired of it. I was getting burnt out dealing with artists because you're dealing with a lot of dudes in the streets. You're dealing with a lot of egos. And then I had one situation with one artist. He wasn't even a street dude. Like it was came to somebody was about to get shot. On him. Wow. Like it was just became too much. And it was just like, I'm just trying to help people. You know what I mean? Right. So I just end up like, you know what? I'm going to move on from this music scene. And then once I moved on from it, I was like kind of stagnant for a little bit. I went back to working and stuff like that. And I was like, I didn't really know what to do next. You know what I mean? I was like, I wanted to get into these different spaces of community. And I was like, I got to start networking more. I got to start being, you know, back into my community more and stuff like that. So that's how I kind of like was like, all right, I'm going to start really being around the people outside of just the music scene, because I was just, my whole network was all rappers and producers and anybody on the music scene, which I still have a connection with a lot of these people, but I didn't have these connections with nonprofits and community leaders and people who's with, you know, just doing different stuff with businesses and doing commercials for schools and doing documentaries for, you know, I did Pittsburgh Underground Railroad documentary. I did that in 2019. A lot of people haven't seen it because I don't have the rights to it. But that's a whole documentary I produced about when slaves came to Pittsburgh. So I would have never been able to do none of these types of dope projects if I would have just stayed in the music scene. I would have just been thinking about the next rapper coming up. And another thing with the music industry is I had to get new clientele every year. It wasn't consistent because I'm like, dudes was getting killed. Dudes was going to jail. Dudes was falling off. You know, it's just like the streets. You know what I mean? The rap game was like the streets is like, soon as one rapper fall off, it's 30 of them to take his place. You know what I mean? I'm trying to build with a rapper, and it's like, yo, I'm trying, you know, we're trying to build a rapport, and he'll end up getting killed or he'll go to jail and get indicted. And it just was like, it came to a point in my life, I was just like, I didn't want to do it no more, yo. I just was tired of it. And like I said, I'm more talented than dudes that rap. Like I am. Like, it's not no knock against nobody. I just got more talent than people. And I know that. And I was like, I got to start putting my own talent first instead of putting everybody else first.
Yeah.
Well, what they're doing. And I was getting money. You know what I mean? It's like, yeah, you get money. But at the end of the day, I got my own projects. I got movies. I got documentary. I got so much
I can
do. TV shows. So it's like, I had to start thinking about myself. I had to be a little bit more selfish to help myself grow. You know what I mean?
Well, I mean, at the end of the day, you have to put the mask on first before assisting others. You know what I mean? And when you find what you are good at, then you're better. I mean, that's what you serve. I mean, if you're looking at, you know, like art and as a service to the community of some sort, as if you're looking at work, like, you know, what are you producing that is worthwhile? You know what I mean? Like, to society, then you're best doing that, not by following the whims of other people, but figuring out what the fuck you need to do. And then working in, like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know. Like, there's some folks that are doing a lot of different shit. Like, but like, I'm a lane type dude. Like, if it's outside of my lane, I don't know. Like,
I ain't got it.
That's not, I don't even.
Lane for a reason.
Yeah, you know, like, that's not me, bro. You know, so I think that's huge. Do you, as a filmmaker, do you have like inspiration? Do you have like some folks that, like, you know what I mean, that you draw from that you grew up, you know, really admiring?
Yeah, I love Spike Lee's my dude.
Mm.
Spike Lee's somebody, because I love Spike Lee movies. I love watching a lot of his old school movies. You know what I mean? I just like his own, he got his own style.
I love that Spike Lee, whenever like, it's like every movie, they just like, it's that moving camera when the ocean movement.
Yeah, where you're standing still.
And standing there and it's...
Yeah, they're like on a platform and they're moving, but the camera's pushing in.
Yeah.
So it's like his own style, man. I always love Spike Lee movies, man. I like a lot of the old Eddie Murphy movies too, from Harlem Nights, Coming to America, ooh, Golden Child. Man. You know what I mean? These just classics, man, that I still go back and watch because I like a lot of comedies. And who's really underrated, that a lot of people don't talk about, who's one of the dopest black directors, is Robert Townsend. Yeah. I mean,
ooh,
Hollywood Shuffle, Five Heartbeats. You know what I mean? A lot of people.
Was this Blank Man?
No, it was Blank Man. Now, Meteor Man was
Meteor
black.
Man. Meteor.
Yeah, wait, hold on.
But it was at the time, it was dope.
Yeah, Meteor, yeah.
It's fire now.
Yeah, it was a black superhero?
Yeah,
I was a comic book nerd. And seeing a black dude, like, I was like, yo, that shit.
I mean, it's not Avengers. If you're going to rate it against Avengers, it's not that. But yo, come on, Meteor Man.
He's not super whack. But it was so, like, in the hood, we used to call my one man Meteor Man as a rip.
That shit was hilarious, man.
But I think where he went wrong, so a lot of times he's in his movies. So we only evaluate him as the actor. Mm. We don't really even view him as a director because we see him on screen. So we, you know, like when you're not in the industry, you can only compartmentalize, right? So if you're showing up in the DVDs, then you're not the producer of these DVDs. You know what I'm saying? Like, so if you're acting in a movie, they think of you as the actor, not the director. You know what I'm saying? But I think what was really cool with Jay, what he learned early on, not early on necessarily, but learning how transferable your talents are.
Mm.
So like, yeah, I can do the DVDs, but this is all visual production. This is all taking your story and bringing it to life.
Yeah.
And there are institutions who need this work done and they have budgets and endowments and shit like that. So I need to walk my ass across the street too. And still keeping that connection to, or that connectivity to, you know, the streets, but like, We all trying to level up.
And that's what I mean, honestly, like, you know, not to harp on it, but I mean, this is a drinking podcast and we run a festival, but I mean, like, you know, we push the whole, like, having a talent and then being like, you know what, I could do the same thing for that industry. Mm-hmm. And there's, yeah, I mean, like the beer industry needs filmmakers. The beer industry needs accountants. Yeah. You know what I mean? They need lawyers. There's so many different, you know what I mean, like, you know, lanes for us. And it's like, I think the thing is that we're not exposed. We're not told, like thrown at. It's not like the opportunity isn't thrown at it. The seeing faces like us in these different, you know, especially in films, right? Like, we don't get to see us as just, you know, that, this, that, all these different ranges. Like, we, a lot of filmmaking, we were regulated to, you know, tropes, like, you know, sidekicks and, you know what I mean, like, buddy cop films and this, that, and the other or whatever. So, you know, I think that translates a lot, you know, like, I don't know, like, I think it translated a lot, like, growing up, a lot of folks are just like, you know what I mean, like, you know, not looking at how they can utilize those skills in different areas.
Like, it'd be like, we're so used to seeing the white savior in movies.
Right.
When we see black people, we like, oh man, they got such and such. We'll hate on it. Because we're so used to, you know what I mean? You know, every Hollywood movie is the white savior. I was just watching Dave Chappelle. The old Dave Chappelle was back on Netflix, Dave Chappelle's show. And they was doing movies or something. They was talking about, it was like a skit. It was Paul Mooney,
yeah.
Two white women. And it was like, ex a black guy or something on films, and they was talking about, he was like, here go Hollywood with they stuff. He was like, now they got Tom Cruise playing The Last Samurai. You know, he was like, Hollywood's always doing the white savior movie. And he's like, I'm just tired of this shit. He said, I'm going to make a movie with starring Tom Hanks called The Last Nigga on Earth. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, they had what it was, ScarJo is notorious for being like the white chick that plays an Asian or some off.
She got that weird, because she's white, but her face is a little bit different.
Yeah, but I mean, they rewrite stories that come from other places. You see, yeah, I mean, they white face it. Yeah, I mean,
Cleopatra, like, Brad Pitt, the Mexican, bastardized her.
Yeah, like, Brad Pitt the Mexican. Yeah, I mean, like, and it's you know, we don't get to see that, but it, like, Spike Lee definitely was a refreshing, yeah, I mean, take on that, and even like Ice Cube, low key, yeah.
Ice Cube
be doing his thing.
Ice Cube's another one.
He be doing his thing.
I just brought up some more of the old school dude. Ice Cube's a dope director, man. I love his film. I like comedies. I like other films. But I'm more, I like comedy movies, man. Like, when I go to sleep, because I'm kind of so, like, traumatized from being in the hood. When I go to sleep, I got to watch comedies so I have an all right dream. Like, I can't watch gunshot movies because I didn't live that so much in my life. Mm. And it's like, really, it's like a mental thing. I'm like, yeah, I'm going to go to sleep watching Harlem Nights. You know what I mean? Mm. Something like that.
I watch movies to be entertained. And I don't always find the drama or being scared. I don't find that entertaining all the time. Comedies are always entertaining. No matter what mood I'm in, something making me laugh is entertaining.
There's just so many bad comedies that I feel like, yeah, I mean, I gotta get, like, if I'm gonna watch a comedy, it's gonna be vetted in some way. I'm not, because there's so many, like, because comedy is subjective.
I think a comedy can go south. It could go south more quickly than maybe a drama. You'll give a lot more leeway to a movie that's supposed to be a drama or a thriller, or, you know what I mean? You'll give a little more leeway because it can turn that corner real quick. With a comedy, it's like, oh, okay, so that dude, this isn't funny. Like, you can kind of figure that out early.
Yeah, early on, yeah. Like, yeah, I mean, within the first, like, 10, 15 minutes, they hit a couple of them, and you're like, not my guy.
Yeah, this ain't going to be the one. This ain't it. So how is COVID now, as a film director, how has COVID affected, you know, your industry, your work? How do you find a difference?
Man, so it was kind of, like, when I look back on it, like, so I had started Pittsburgh Black Film Network.
Mm-hmm.
So I did two events. This was last year in February.
Is that what is B Cook in that?
No, he's Pittsburgh Black Media Federation. Media,
that's what it is. Okay.
Yeah, I'm a member of that. So I had this started Pittsburgh Black Film Network. So I was just bringing together everybody black in the city in film. So we did two networking events at Arnold's Tea at Claudie's old spot.
Yeah. Shout out to Claudie.
Both events. One event had 50 people. The other event had 60 people. And then this was in December, January, and then February, we did five black short films from five black film directors here in the city of Pittsburgh. We did that at the Homewood YMCA. That was like at the end of, it's a year ago now.
Yeah.
And then COVID hit. So we had some steam. I had the whole panel. So we played the five black short films and we had like 100 something people there. Then I had like a whole email database. Everybody was coming out, was getting emails. I still got everybody's email. And we did the five short films. We had the panel. You know, I was just, you know, narrow. You know, I was the host. asking them questions about their film and stuff like that. People in the crowd asked questions. It was a dope event. Next month, COVID hits. You know what I mean? And I'm not really like, film is not a Zoom type of thing. So I lost some motivation with it. You know what I mean? I was like, man, this is butt. I'm not getting on Zooms and talking about our movie. Like, film is a face type of thing. You need to meet with the directors. You need to see these people face to face. And it was like, I didn't have time to really create it like an online platform because it was so new. And it was booming. And then it kind of like sizzled out. So now that I have my own space, I'm like, I'm going to just get it back cracking again. You know what I mean? I got my own space. So I'm like, we just get it back cracking again. So
I mean, how do you, so as a film director, now obviously you have a talent in making things come to life on screen or on camera, right? Everything we're doing is on camera to some extent. Are the request for type of work different, or how do you I guess film is something you capture, edit, and whatnot, and now everything is to be live streamed or to be in the moment. Like how do film directors fit into that? How do you know with the restrictions being lifted or pull back a bit, like how do you now get back into creating content yourself? Like what are restrictions on that? City permits and shit like that. Like how does that work for your industry?
Bro, I ain't gonna hold you. I don't get permits, bro. I'm not paying for no permits, bro. I'm a guerrilla filmmaker, bro. Like
is that okay?
Most of the time I'm filming in the hood and I know, so I'll go film. So I do location scouting. I'm gonna go somewhere where I know the street ain't got a lot of traffic, where it got a nice look to it. Pittsburgh got a lot of different looks. We got industrial looks. We got all these hills. Then we got parts that look like New York. We got parts that look like Baltimore with row houses. We got parts that look like different cities. You know what
That's
I mean?
And wild to have a...
Out to like the Mon Valley, yeah. It got a different look. So truthfully, I wouldn't suggest nobody going to go get no permits. I've never been...
We at the drinking party. Yeah. Not endorsed.
I've never
film break.
Said he the Banksy. He's the Pittsburgh Banksy out here. Like, when you see you got to come find me.
Well, I guess at that point, once it's filmed, they can't do nothing with it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, there's nothing they can do. And when the police don't bother you anyway. Now, if you're doing something and you shutting down a whole street, yeah, you know what I mean? But a lot of the stuff we do filming, we're not in these areas to where it's in the middle of traffic and, you know, we got to shut down this whole
street. You flying under the radar, you know what I mean? And, I was just having a conversation, you know what I mean, like about, you know, like there's a lot of illegal shit. A lot of people do a lot of illegal shit. You just got to know, yeah, I mean, where the radar is and just not be all, police, you know what I mean? Don't be out here wilding out, you know what I mean? You know, I mean, there's billionaires did not get there by following all the rules. I'm just gonna say that. I feel like
Adam is the biggest crooks.
Well, the rules are built to keep you in the collective class, like in that lower. So anyone who's in that other class found a loophole and exploited it. Like,
we saw GameStop. We saw, yeah, I mean,
well,
we
that's
saw,
new. That's we, a new. But saw, they shut. But they shut down. They shut down a whole site. They shut down trading.
They changed the rules out this motherfucker. Like you know what I mean? You talk about rules.
None of this shit is real. You should do a documentary on how none of the shit we grew up believing is real. None of it is real. The weather ain't real no more. The fucking money's not real. You walk outside and all of a sudden you got
nothing we was taught in school.
Nothing. Nah. None of this shit
all
is real
history,
anymore.
History microfiche, bruh.
You know what I mean? Microfiche lessons I had.
Like, it's crazy because I envy those who have this workable talent, like with filmmaking, right? Again, transferable to all industries. So it's your talent, you invest in yourself. And it's terrible that we're not taught at an early age to invest in ourselves. Investment is always give someone some money and time to validate you, as opposed to investing all your money and time into what you believe in. And you can validate yourself by reaching whatever it is you set for yourself. Like it's crazy. So now you have in Beltsuver, you have a space. And I don't know what to even, because everybody gets a space now. It's almost like you get a commercial space not to have a definition behind it. It's like to have a space that's just a restaurant would be silly. Like to have a space where you could do anything in it is kind of the move moving forward, especially now that folks are kind of
mixed use spaces and whatnot, comment like, yeah, I mean, in themselves, like, it's like co-ops and things.
I got four walls for you.
Yeah, true. Yeah. I mean, and it's that same mentality with like the families, how like, yeah, I mean, you like multi-family like living or whatever, where, you know, you pull those resources under one roof long enough until, you know, like incubation type things, you know what I mean? Like, you know, there's power in numbers.
So where's your space and what you trying to do out of it?
So our space is it's at 401 Warrington, but we use 400 Cicero Way. We use the alleyway address because actually there's a tenant downstairs that rents it out, and she uses, you know what I mean? She uses the 401 Warrington. So we use the 400 Cicero Way, which is the alleyway right across from the old Warrington swimming pool, which is a spray park now. We use the space for multi-purpose, like you just said. Like, I got a photography backdrop up in there in the open warehouse space. We got half of it turf. So we work out in there. We got kids come and work out. A lot of the Brashear football players come and work out in there. So my business partner, he does a lot of stuff with student athletes. He coaches at Brashear. He does contracts within the school. So we got community kids coming in there. We got people coming in to get photography shoots. I got my actual stuff set up for my TV show, but I haven't even did nothing with it yet. So I got a whole podcast set up in there for a room, but I just got the equipment sitting in there. So we got different rooms. So we've did two funeral repasses in there because the churches was closed. People from the community that passed away. So we let people's birthday parties in there. We did a Halloween party. So we only been in there since October 1st. And we came in, it's 4,000 square feet in the building. We came in, like, you couldn't even go in there without a mask on because it was mold and stuff. So we had to basically, I pressure washed the whole building from top to bottom, the warehouse space, you know what I mean? Because it's brick wall. So I pressure washed it. We came and we pulled the installation out, put new drywall, and we did a lot, put new floors down. We did a lot to the building just to get it up to a decent, where, you know what I mean, where it's at now since October, you know, since October 1st.
Damn, the funeral repass, that's a whole different lane.
Yeah. I told a couple people passed away in the community. It was actually two young girls passed away like back to back from the community. And, you know, it was nowhere for them to do the repass at, you know, with the family and eat food. So we let them use the space. So we did birthday parties there, kids parties so far. You know, we just been doing, I just did an adult game night and I did it kind of small, intimate type crowd, but I'm going to do another adult game night where I'm just going, you know, open it up to Facebook and let people come. You know, I had the big Jenga, I had the big Connect Four, the Twister. I got a black trivia game. I got off Pop and Shani, Chantel. She got this black trivia game. It's like fun and stuff like that. I had the big checkers and stuff like that. So I got some big games and then some regular size games. So just different stuff like that. Bringing, like I told you, hey, I want to do some comedy shows in there, bring some comedians in, do some stuff with some live bands, you know, just different stuff. Open mic nights, just do different stuff for an older crowd. You know what I mean? I'm not necessarily just trying to do parties and stuff. That's not really what I'm into. So I'm just like, it's just a space to be utilized, man, for the communities. You know, we need more black spaces. We don't have a lot of black spaces here on the South Side to be utilized.
So as a filmmaker, like, what does it look like? You know what I mean? Like as technology, as folks, you know, like, you know, like the industry and the art and it moves forward. What does that look like on your side? Like, you know what I mean? Like keeping up with the pace of transition. Like, I know, like, you know, like with comedy, the industry is ever evolving, especially with the pandemic, man. Like, you know, venues are going to be different. Like, you know, the ways in which we can broadcast instead of just being, you know, in person, you know, having to utilize, you know, films and filmmakers and cameras in order to, you know, get out there or whatever. But then even in that, there's, you know, 4Ks and 8Ks and all kind of weird. Like, I don't understand any of it, but, you know, how do you stay abreast of like the changes in the industry and what does that take?
So what I do is you got to keep investing in yourself. I was always the type of person that was always into investing in myself. Like, whether when I was in the streets, when I rap, when I hustle, I invested in myself. I just was always the type. I come from a hustling background. So I was never the type of person that stayed on the same level. Even when I was in the streets and I sold crack, I never was like, I'm just going to sit on this and I'm just being real. I'm not going to sit on this eight ball. I'm trying to go to a bird. Like, I'm just, that's just the type of person I are. So I keep that same mentality with everything I do. People put all this energy and the street shit and, you know, try to do all, you know, but you could take that same energy that you have from the streets and put it behind something positive.
Yes.
And get way better results. So I'm always like, okay, the 4K camera's out now. All right. So when I do these three jobs, I'm going to just buy this 4K camera. Or I'm going to keep, every time I do a job, I just consistently buy equipment. You know, every job I do, I got to buy something to keep up with the times. Hold on 1 second. My son is acting crazy. Hold on.
I think he brings a good point, because I think whenever we have folks in the streets, right, like, we never teach them that they have these competencies that transfer into the corporate world. Yeah. Like, when you are a drug dealer, for example, right? If you the plug, you're dealing with supply chain. You're dealing with management of a workforce. You're dealing with supply and demand. You're dealing with all of these things, and you're managing these things.
Mm-hmm.
And we just don't know that these skills are transferable, because we're never taught to invest in ourselves.
Yeah, like, we have been doing things like and didn't know there was a title for it. You know what I mean?
Bruh.
Like, you know, and that's the thing. That's one of the craziest things that I've learned. Is like about my own personal journey and being like, oh, that's what that's called. Like, you know what I mean? And then seeing people doing that and being like, well, you know, you could actually make money doing that. Yeah,
and
I mean,
seeing them be like, mad mediocre at the shit, like having to work for a month. You like, I come off the streets now. I done had to, you know, be the plug and do all this and manage all this. And I come, I'm like, oh, I'm trying to clean up my life. And I come sit in this corporate world and I'm watching this dude mismanage shit. I'm like, bro, you could have done this or told this dude this, and it could have boom, boom, whoop, whoop. You're like, oh,
but that
man.
Dude had the money in the background, you know what I mean, to go through to get a piece of paper and then the connection to get that gig.
Right.
And that's not because they were better than, you know, I mean, you had the job. It just, yeah, I mean,
they knew the rules of the game and played it.
Yeah, exactly. And like I said, I mean, like, the more successful you are, the more you start to realize, like, oh, wait, there's so many different lanes out there, especially if you're willing to not be beholden and like pigeonhole and say, you know what, I'm only doing this, that, or the other. Like, if you open up and say, like you said, you're like, yo, look, rap thing is cool. But there's other, like, lanes that I feel more, you know what I mean? Like, you know, but it takes a lot to let that go. You know what I mean? Like, that's really the hang up is saying, like, it's getting outside your comfort zone. Yeah, and that's the only place that change happens, is getting outside. You got to do something where you might fail. You know what I mean?
Right.
In comedy, we got to go back to open mics. We got to go back to that. That five, you got to build 5 minutes again. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And it's hard to do that when you're used to just crushing and da da da.
Yeah, when you got a strong 30. It's hard to try that new five. Like, I got this 30 that I got this 30 tucked, and I can do that last 15 first.
Yeah.
And then it's a different set, but it don't be like that. So I want to shout you out. I think this is our first true and genuine COVID cast, right? Because people don't understand, like, having to deal with kids is a lot, man. Like, that's why I leave mine at the crib, man. That's why I'm doing a podcast.
He woke up. My wife left. She was like, well, I got to go up to, because my wife has a spa. Shout out to my wife.
Shout out.
Boyle White.
She got
Steam Beauty and Wellness Spa.
There you go.
You know what I mean? My wife got her own spa. So she's like, I got to run up to the spa and do something. And he was sleeping. He ended up waking up, and I already knew it was going to be something. So I had to take them to the hospital yesterday.
I was
everything good with them?
Cool. Good. Yeah, they was just thrown up real bad the last few days, but they got some medicine in them, so they doing better now. So, you know, life of a dad, man, you know?
Yeah, so I was irresponsible and had kids when I was young. So now they all, like, you know, they DDs and things that day. You know what I mean? Like, they are old now. So, like, everybody is like, and y'all, and I get it, because, like, you know, that's responsible shit. You got much more capital and understand spas and shit. And that's like, yeah, y'all got the community space and a spa.
Two entrepreneurs in a household.
Yeah.
Like, how is that? How does that work now, though? So you got
it's a trade off. So basically, sometimes when I'm coming, my wife is gone. You know what I mean? So, like, so we make sure, like, okay, we take the kids to the babysitter on Friday and Saturday, because my wife works really long on Saturdays. So I'm able to get work done on Friday evening. And then it's like, we got to do date night. So we kind of like trade off. So it's like, all right, every other week we do date night. And then one Friday will be her day. And then one Saturday will be my day to just, you know, if I want to go out with my boys or just, you know, I got to film something. So we just kind of trade off. We just kind of created a schedule. But it wasn't always like this because a few years ago, we both was working for somebody. You know what I mean? She was working. I was working for my uncle for a painting company, and she was working for European Wax. And the best thing that happened to her, she got fired from European Wax. Like you said, getting outside your comfort zone. Mm. And she got fired because she was pregnant with my daughter right here, Kimora, messing with my hat. And they did her dirty. But it was like, and she ended up getting her own spa. So it was like being
that's
an entrepreneur.
Some of the best opportunities getting fired from shit. Yeah. Man, because you was holding on to it.
It's great because we get to have our own time, but it's like we don't because you got to run the business. You got to do the paperwork. You got to do. So it's like less time, but it's better. You're more at peace. You don't got nobody looking down your back, working. You know, when you work a job for people, it's stressful, bro, especially as a black man working these jobs, bro. It's like we don't really fit in. So it's like I push for a lot more black men to get trades, to be entrepreneurs. But some people still have to work a job because you need consistent money. The entrepreneur life is not how everybody makes it seem.
So I guess touch on that because they are two different types of stress. Yeah, I mean, because it's like working for somebody is stressful as shit, but so is having your own shit. Like it's not like as soon as you become your own boss and everything is like fun and easy. Like, yeah, I mean, like it's two different, like how, you know, so I guess elaborate more on the two, like the two different types of stresses that you're seeing and then how you continue, you know, like, cause self-motivation is weird. Like, you know what I mean? Having to come up with a schedule and say this, you know what I mean? And when it's easy when you say, all right, you got, it opens here, closes here, here's the vacation time, this, that, and the other. It's another thing when it's like, well, whatever I decide to do or whatever, which is again, a different type of stress.
Working for somebody stress. So I worked for my uncle, so it was cool.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? You know what I mean? With a painting company. So my uncle, he gets a lot of big contracts in the city through Mystic. You know, he does a lot of stuff through Mystic Construction. So he got his own painting company. So I learned how to paint from working with my uncle. We did a lot of prep work, but it was cool working for my uncle, but I was in the labor's union for like a year. And that, I was like, oh, hell no. I was looking around at them old dudes, man. Shh. I'm talking. And I was like, this ain't what I want to do coming home. I'm jackhammering. My hands is like this. I'm like, nah. And then it was just like dealing in that labor's union. I'm like, this is racist as hell. Like, it was just a racist environment. It was all dudes from outside the city, white dudes from outside the city who was Republicans and Trump supporters. And it's not that you're a Trump supporter, you're a racist. But a lot of these dudes
are Trump supporter, you're racist. Yeah, I mean, I'm going to have to say on the record.
Yeah.
All right, well, okay.
It's not that, but probably.
Yeah, probably. Right. Like 99.9999.
Yeah, me. Like, there's very few. But yeah.
But just being in that environment, I'm like, I was making good money, but I was like, this ain't it. You know what I mean? This ain't it. I'm like, this ain't where it's at. And doing that, and it's like working for people, and it's like these people got this jurisdiction over you. Like, you want more to have your own freedom. You want to kind of be your own boss, but it takes a lot. So a lot of people think, like I go back to, everybody can't be an entrepreneur and be their own boss. A lot of people need to work for people because they're not good at time. Like, I'm not that great at time management. My wife tells me, because I got 5-6 projects I'm working on. But now this year I have said, yo, I'm getting more staff. I need to delegate work to other people.
Delegation is hard.
Editors. I spend majority of my life editing. I go out and film. It might be 2-3 hours or 5-6 hours, but I might be editing that same project. Okay. I might be editing that same project for 20 hours. You know what I mean? That's what people don't understand.
Buzzy got to appreciate that. I know Buzzy in the back like gospel. The
editing process is what takes up most of your life. You know what I mean?
No, editing, you can, I've been on a lot of film and we've been on a lot of film and recording, but the editing is that's what you're paying for. You know what I mean?
And that's what people don't understand. They think you just film stuff and you magically appear. So it's like, as a business owner, I have to edit. I have to film. Like, when I get bigger projects, I do bring my boys on board. So I'm like, yo, I need, you know what I mean? I need a DP. I need an audio guy. You know what I mean? So when a project is bigger, but every project's not big. So a lot of times it's just me. I'm setting up the lights. I'm coming in with the audio. You know what I mean? Stuff like that. But it's a lot. It's a lot of hard work. You know what I mean? So I advise everybody, if you want to be your own boss, to do some business classes, to do some, you know what I mean? Go take some little courses to learn about more just about business and managing it. And, you know what I mean? The whole side of it, accountants and, you know what I mean? Having a lawyer, you need all these things when you're an entrepreneur. A lot of people don't even do some of these steps. You know what I mean? I got a business lawyer. I got, you know what I mean? There's accountants. There's all these people out here. I get my credit together. You know what I mean? You want to establish business credit. It's a lot more than just like, oh yeah, you know, I'm a business owner and taking people's money and you ain't doing the business. You know what I mean? You ain't doing stuff right. So it's a lot of accountability on yourself.
It's a different, like it's really hard because it's hard to recognize a talent.
Yeah.
There's recognizing a talent and then there's running a business based on that talent. You know what I mean? Like you might be a dope ass seamstress, but can you be a business owner? Like, yeah, I mean, like you might be best skilled. Like there's certain skills that I have that are best served under somebody else's like business ownership. Yeah, you know I mean, like, you know, if I had, there's certain shit that I would just rather show up and do than having to create the avenues and all the other shit in order to do that. Yeah, you know I mean, like, and
me
I think
push back on that. Let me push back on that because what I think COVID has taught us is your talents are your business, right? So when I first finished college, right, all my boys was going out, they was going to DC, and everybody became a consultant. And I don't know, 10 years later, I still don't know what the fuck that means. But basically what it means is I get to tell you how this shit can work best for your business, right? So if you have a talent, so like people, it's just like in your industry with editing, right? I could just be, my business could be Ed Bailey Inc. and all I do is edit. And that way I don't have to worry about getting the projects, you know, thinking of the you know, what the film's going to look like. All I do is edit. And so it's scale. A lot of times it's scale and setting goals. And that's where I think a lot of folks who go into entrepreneurship kind of fail. They don't think of the scale. What resources do you have now? You know what I'm saying? What can you pay for? What can you outsource? What do you have to do in-house? Your biggest resource is your time. So how much time do you have? If you got two kids, you can't do as much as somebody who doesn't have any kids who could stay up late. You know what I'm saying? What are you physically? Right. Are you a night person? Are you a morning person? You know, and then scale. I mean, and so you got time, you got resource, you got scale. And then just so the scale is how big do you want to be, right? Because I can be very successful at this level. And then once I reach that goal, then what is the next step to get to the next level? That next step may be having a contracted editor or having, you know what I mean? So it's, you can be, I think what I'm seeing now is you can be an entrepreneur. You just got to be smart about it. And everybody wants to be an entrepreneur with the big business, with the big booming business immediately. And that's not how those people got to that point.
I think that there's like you're saying, you have to, do you have the skill set to manage your, like you, like manage your time and do all that? Because like I said, I mean, there might come a point where I'm just lazy as shit. Like, and I might just go back to just working for,
want to be an entrepreneur.
Cause there's, you know, you have health insurance, you have a set time, you know, you don't have to be in sales. You don't have to be, you know, like you could be a part of an organization already, let somebody else utilize, do all that other shit and just be like, you know what? I just want to show up and work on, you know, nerd shit like accounting sheets. I don't want to have to worry about clients. I don't want to have to worry about like advertising. I don't want to have to worry. I just want to show up, do my motherfucking job, take the money, my health insurance, and live a good life in Florida from time to time. And that, you know, and there's nothing wrong with that.
No,
you know
there's nothing like, wrong with that. That's cool, I mean? For a lot
that's,
of people.
That's cool as shit.
More people should do that.
Yeah, yeah, I mean, like, you know, and then you know, and then there's folks that are just like, you know, I want to do that, but you have to figure out like, and I think it's to it. You have to be educated, and that's the first, like you said, take some classes, maybe have conversations with other entrepreneurs, like build a circle. You know what I mean? Like, I'm more successful in comedy, in festival, in anything, podcasting, because we're surrounded by people who do that already. So if you want to do that, get around people that already do that. I don't want to own a brewery because I'm surrounded by a bunch of people that own breweries, and I'm like, yo, that shit is hard. Yeah. And like that sounds like a terrible lifestyle. You know what I mean? I think it's the education side that comes with it, and then assessing your skill set and going, you know what? Yeah, because at the end of the day, you're right. We are a small business. Even if you're an accountant at some other place, your small business is accounting, and you're contracting that work to that business that's paying you, you sound the check.
Like a C-suite exec. They always tell their employees, you're your own business. You're your own business.
You got to negotiate that shit. Because as millennial, my mom, she works a job. She got a pension. She works until she's retired. It's over. Now, like, you got a job. And if you're going to make more money, you got to basically jump to another job. You know what I mean? Like, the very few places are going to pay you on scale with the rise of, you know, I mean, whatever. You got to get some skills, get some shit on your resume, and then jump to another job to get up to that thing. So, in a sense, you got to start looking at it as contractors.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. My family, I don't come from a family of, like, I'm like one of the first generation entrepreneurs. Like, my uncle that has the painting company from my dad's side, you know, he started his own company. But my granddad, he's still living. My granddad's 83. My granddad's favorite line, y'all need to get a job. You know what I mean? Well, granddad, we don't want to work on the railroad. Yeah, that's what you did, bro. Like, we don't want to do that. You know what I mean? We ain't trying to get that dirty. We ain't trying to be out there with the old sledgehammer hitting metal and stuff. You know what I mean? But that's how he grew up.
Right.
That's how my grandma grew up. You know what I mean? They didn't never like think about entrepreneurship and owning their own business, which is fine. You know what I mean? They had a great, successful life. You know what I mean? Them two together. But it's like, whatever your path is, and a lot of people, what gets a lot of people messed up, everybody wants to follow everybody else's path instead of creating. And it's not that you want to create your own lane. Find something that you like to do. So if you're doing it, I love film. So even if I don't make a lot of money doing it, I still love it. You know what I mean? Even though I do good, even though if I didn't, I still love it. I still have a passion for it. It's something I want to do. We don't have black movies in Pittsburgh. I did my movie Everyday Hustle. I freestyled it. I did a movie with no script. I freestyled a whole feature film, 65 minutes. Then I premiered it at the August Wilson Center. And the week I premiered it, the people from the August Wilson Center was on the news. They was like, oh, yeah, we got Faith Evans coming. We got the such and such band. Said everybody's event except for mine, a black filmmaker from the city that y'all should be embracing, that y'all should be like, yo, we got an up-and-coming black filmmaker from Pittsburgh. And I'm not mad at that, but I'm just saying that's the type of
stuff
that goes on. Like, and it's like, I created a movie from nothing, just me and my daughter in this house right here. And I was just, one day she was 6 months and she was crying. My wife was at work. I was laid off from the labor's union. Now I was still doing my camera work, but this is our time. And I was just like, man, what if I was a single dad? I said, my life would be crazy at 40 years old. You know what I mean? I'm 40 I got 8 children. So these are my 2 younger children. I got 6 children from a previous marriage. My children live in North Carolina with my ex-wife. So go back to this film thing, but I was just in the house with her, me and her. And I was like, I was a single dad.
You got it.
This would be crazy at 40 years old. You know, she was crying. And I was like, well, what if I made a little documentary about being a single dad? And I'm like, I don't want to make a documentary. I've made 7 documentaries. You know what I mean? So I was like, what if I made a little short film about being a single dad? I'm going to act like I'm struggling. And I was like, well, I'm going to act like I'm jitneying and stuff like that, because I did jitney before and I know how to jitney. So I was like, I'll just ask my man to use his jitney station. And I just start coming up with ideas about how I knew it. My wife is seeing me. She's like, what are you doing? I said, I'm shooting a movie. She's like, what? Like, she didn't really take it serious until I was like, yo, I'm premiering this movie at the August Wilson Center. She's like, oh, you really was like, I'm like, yeah. So I shot it in March and April, and I learned from that, because I was like, I'll never shoot a movie again in March and April in Pittsburgh, because it rains, it snows, it's sun out. So I got the same outfit on. You might see snow on the ground, then you might see it's sunny out. You're like, hold up. The continuity of it was off. You know what I mean? But it was a learning process of me doing that. And it was like, we don't have a lot of black content here. We don't have a lot of black films. My man Rashid, they did Blood First. They shot that kind of like out. They shot that in Homewood and on the east side. That was like 2014. But we don't have a lot of movies, feature films. And my movie wasn't perfect. I wasn't trying to make it perfect. But I was like, I'm doing a fucking movie. I'm doing it. And I did it. And I premiered it. I sold 500 tickets at the August Wilson Center. I sold DVDs of it. I sold T-shirts. I had the little gift bags with some of my old products in there. And I just did it. I marketed it, promoted it. Pre-production, produced it. I did every step damn near on my own. A couple people helped me film a couple scenes, but I did it from start to finish off one single idea.
Yeah.
Just me being in the house with my daughter. And it was like, I did a feature film and I freestyled it and I put it in a lot of these film groups. And these people's like, how did you shoot a movie with no script? They're like, it's like it's impossible to do it. Because I was like, I'm just talented. I know what I wanted to do. And I just created scenes and I went off personality. So I was like, all right, Ed, I know you funny. You from Cleveland. So all right, I could use your personality to do this scene. And that's what I went off. I didn't go off who was popping or this and that. I went off people's personalities for each scene. So I'm like, all right, my one boy, he's more of a corporate. I'll act like I'm going on a job interview to get a job with his company. But I had to take my daughter because I couldn't get a babysitter. So that's like one of the opening scenes. I had my daughter in a job interview because I couldn't get a babysitter. So I'm like acting like I'm calling my mom on the phone. It's just, I just created a whole film off of nothing.
Yeah. You know, and I think that's the thing that holds up most endeavors is, you know, people are like, oh, what do you know, advice on how to do this, that, and the other. And it's like, you got to do it. Like, you know what I mean? If you're waiting for the perfect opportunity, it's never going to come. It's never going to come. You have to
save us.
You got it. Yeah. I mean, your savior is in the mirror. Yeah. I mean, like, you know, we were built, on his image. So yeah, I mean, that's where you got to go to get that. But before we get out of here, I just want to shout out Cajun Fire. This has been an amazing beer. Shout out to John. He sent up this P-Train Funk IPA, a raspberry milkshake IPA. Just insane. We got video
and,
now.
Yeah. And shout out to
upgrade.
John.
Shout out to
John holds you down too, man. Like I went down to New Orleans shit almost a year ago and hit him up. You know what I'm saying? He came, he met me at the hotel, brought me a shitload of beer. I was like, fam, I got to get on a plane. It's just me and wifey. Like, how we going to drink all this beer? We can't just take this. It's like, I'm like, I don't even know if I could fly this back to the city. Like, I'm not trying. I got to go to work on Monday.
Brewers don't have an understanding of reality, man. They just be handing you and pouring you like quantities. Yeah, that just is like, listen, man, we ain't like, I'm a
fam, I can't put this whole... I'm like, where am I gonna put my clothes?
Like, I'm a mortal crazy. Out this, brother. We live that, regular man. Shit. But no, I mean, it's wild because this is a year round that he does. And a milkshake IPA, a raspberry milkshake IPA can go off the rails. Like, you know, we were talking earlier with Afro Beer Chick about how, like, you know, pastry styles and different styles can kind of be a little too much. And something like a raspberry milkshake IPA sounds like it could be a lot, but this is very well balanced. Like it's a nice touch of sweet and lactose. And yeah, I mean, I feel like it's a nice beginner's beer if you want to be like accustomed, like, you know, to hops. Like, I mean, right. The hops are in there, but they ain't like hops,
overbearing.
Motherfucker.
Yeah, it ain't overbearing. And it's his thought. It's his baby, right? He was like, this is my idea. This is what I'm going to do. And I think it ties in well to this episode because, you know, self-made on the other end, on this laptop, man, we applaud you, you know, Jay, just for being self-made. And I think that last story about the film that you made from scratch without a script, I think that's a great tie into the episode. You know, invest in yourself, invest in your talents, man, and just get it done. You know what I mean? Yeah. You got all the resources around you, anywhere you are, especially if you're in the hood. The hood got so much motherfucking talent, man, and we just really have to focus and direct it in that right way. And you have, you know, the possibilities are endless and you have, you know, good outcomes on the other end. Now, Dave's finna ask you a question that you don't have to answer.
Yeah, you have to answer. It's just that, yeah, I mean.
He asks every motherfucker
it's a question that everybody has an answer for. What is your favorite form of potato?
Favorite form of potato?
Mm-hmm.
You don't got an answer?
Probably Idaho. That's the ones I use.
Nah, not the.
See,
nah,
see, that's
not
a hood
the,
ass
not
answer. Like, yeah, question don't even make no. See, thank you. Finally, somebody on the say just because it makes me. Yeah,
I guess it's technically, but no. What like what kind of like what do you do with that Idaho potato? What's your favorite? Like fries, mashed, like
French fries, yo. Fresh cut French fries is
fresh
is
cut.
Fine.
That's your fresh cut.
Old school originals, fresh cut
fries, are the best fucking fries ever. I mean, hand cut.
Ah, yeah, it ain't nothing like it, yo.
Because it's loving
with a little bit of salt.
Yeah, I do with mine. I throw them in there to the grease for a little bit, then I take them out. You know what I mean?
Do you cut them?
I put them back in.
You cut them by hand, or you got the little thing that
I used to have a thing, but now I cut them by hand.
Still cut them by hand. Do you peel them all the way down, or you leave the skin on them?
My wife don't like the skin on hers, but I keep the skin on mine.
You gotta have the skin on them,
motherfuckers. Oh, so you're making two different type of fresh cuts for dinner?
Wow,
that's love right there. Proof. Hey, yo,
when I make them, I'm just keeping the skin on.
Oh, you gotta have that. Yeah, you know I mean,
he love you. He make yours skinless, and I see you in the background. Yours is skinless. He got skin on his. Love that man. I'm always on the fella side because they don't never want to recognize the shit we go through. They never do. I heard her humming.
Like noise.
I had a wild ass thought in the car the other day. Do you understand? Like, yo, when women ask this shit and we be like, it don't matter, like. It's not that it don't matter. It's one of two. It's two things. It's one, we know that it matters more to you. That's really what that means.
Yeah, that's real.
It matters less to me, and you already know how you want it. And since it matters more to you, just tell me what it's gonna be, please.
That's it. Yeah.
And if you don't like skin on your fries, Jay gonna make yours skinless, and he gonna have skin on his. You gonna have 7 fries left for skin.
I live with a vegetarian. I got a meatless side of the grill, and that's a weird thing.
Sacrifice.
You know?
And every time she gives you shit.
When somebody's vegetarian, they don't play
got
that.
A meatless side of the grill. I'm like, it's burning, but you
So. I'm the same way like that because I don't eat beef and pork. So if I go to somebody's cookout or something and they done threw the ribs next to the turkey burgers, come on, man. Bro. Cook the turkey burgers first.
If they were to cook the turkey burgers first, that's sacrifice for you. And that's what you're doing for that lady all the time. And you take that energy and you let her know. You tell her, you my turkey burger.
Over there shaking her head. Like,
you're his turkey burger, damn it.
The impossible burger.
So let the people know where they can find you, Jay.
You can find me on Instagram at jaywhitedigitalmedia, J-A-Y White Digital Media. On Facebook is James S. White. You can follow my business page, which is Jay White Digital Media. And on Instagram, Twitter, I'm Jay White Digital.
And then if they want to book the space in the 210, let them know the address and how they can get to that. Yeah.
So just contact me off of Facebook or Instagram if you want to rent the space, if you want to come get a photo shoot, you want to get some headshots, you want to get an interview, you know, you want to put a movie together. You know, I'm all for collabing with the people, man. You know what I mean? I just like being around creatives, people who got great ideas. You know, I just brought on a young script writer yesterday. Me and him had a meeting, so I'm going to let him write one of my scripts that I have that I almost have done. But I made a video, too. I said, James White owns the rights to this film, right? So I put
that. That's the entrepreneur coming out.
But I'm like, this will hold up in court. But no, I just like collabing with people, man, and just bringing people on board and just doing great stuff, man. You know what I mean? I just like creative, you know, being around people who's creative. So I'm also creating some stuff. I also got a pilot episode I'm working on that I have the young boy write, and that'll be able to incorporate a lot of people in the city, which is a comedy. So I'm doing this one episode, and then we're going to pitch it and put it out there and then make it into more of a TV series. So that'll be something that I'll be able to incorporate a lot of the comedians, a lot of people who's just in the city who want to just be a part of it. So in due time. So this first episode, I'm not going to be able to put every single person in it, but it's just something I just like.
Scale.
In film, I can't do everything myself. So I'm always a team player. Yes, so it's like everything, like even y'all bringing me on the show, I appreciate y'all for bringing me on the show and just being as a community, you know what I mean? We're a community as one. So that's how we got to get back to, and that's how we got to think. Like, everything I think of is in film because I can't do it all by myself. I need other cameramen. I need somebody to do audio. So that's how I just go about life. Like, you need people and you need, you know, everybody got to stick together, man, and make it happen. It takes all of us to make something happen. So.
Yes, sir. And Dave, let the people know where they can find us if they don't know.
Hey, man, if you're looking for us, you can find us on epicastnetwork.com/partnerspod. You can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, Libsyn, Google Play, and Spotify under Drinking Partners. You can find us on iTunes, Stitcher, and Libsyn. Oh, hey, hold on. Well, you can find us on IG, Facebook, and Twitter at Partners Pod, man.
Yeah, it's that two new beardless face, that rape face. Well, listen, I want to thank our...
Got the old school DJ voice.
Yeah. We want to thank Jay White, a.k.a. Rough Bone, for joining us, man, and dropping jewels about entrepreneurship, man. Invest in yourself. And you know, you have time. You have time and talent. You know, make it happen. But don't rush. You know what I mean? Take time. It's not something that's going to happen overnight. But it's something that's definitely not going to happen if you don't invest. So, as always, Drinking Partners is the crew. Epicast is the family. And we out of here. Appreciate that, man. Thank you for the COVID cast, man. It's been too smooth. Like, somebody got to have some fucking kids so they know what's going on, man. Like,
swear you heard mine's in the background.
Listen, man, they don't respect nothing. As soon as I walk in, boy, my kids be like, you on the phone? Don't matter. I got